The conflict of mind, part three, starting with section seven. We now turn to the question of justification. If someone presents me one piece of irrefutable evidence in favor of case X, am I justified to believe X, or do I need two pieces of irrefutable evidence? Why not three or four? Certainly would depend on the quality of the evidence, and being convinced is ultimately a combination of evidential quality and quantity. But by what standard do I measure quality? And when I am convinced by quality, is it according to an emotional, subjective, or objective standard? Consider these questions. First, at what point are we justified to trust X? At what point are we justified to consider X evidence for against case Y? At what point do we have practical certainty about X? At what point am I justified to accept axiom X versus axiom Y, which will function as a baseline against which I can define epistemic irresponsibility or responsibility? At what point do I cease to be epistemically responsible, to be skeptical, and to begin being a nihilistic doubter who ultimately negates himself? At what point do we decide, based on assessment, a person has lied or told false information as truth enough to justify assuming the person will always mislead and or to justify not talking with that person again? At what point have we investigated a case enough to be justified to claim the case is true or false? At what point are we justified to trust that our experts, scholars, and media are being epistemically responsible for us? At what point does a conspiracy theory garner enough hard evidence to become a theory enough to become a truth? At what point of plausibility do we decide that one conspiracy theory is epistemically responsible to investigate and not another? At what point of investigation are we justified to claim this is endless and or I'm taking a pitch and risk and hence are justified to turn back before it's too late? At what point are we justified to claim X is actually a pitch and risk versus only appear as such? If we say that epistemic responsibility would obligate a person to investigate all the questions of life up to point X but not point Y, lest the person goes crazy, how would we be justified to make this claim? At what point would we be justified to say, I am only epistemically responsible for investigating claims that meet the standards of epistemic model X and or epistemic methods X, Y, and Z? At what point of time are we justified to say, it is probable that X will be true after X has been true thus far? In other words, at what point are we justified to say, it is probable that insert? At what point are we justified to be reasonable though not epistemically responsible? In other words, at what point are we justified not to be justified? At what point are we justified to claim X is a racist, X is person, cup, cat, etc., any description or identity? At what point are we justified to say, I don't think like everyone else? At what point are we justified to think issue X is more important than issue Y? At what point are we justified to change our standard of justification, hence changing the standard against which we define epistemic responsibility, hence perhaps making it seem like we were always epistemically responsible when such might not be the case? And we could go on with examples. Perhaps it is better not to ask about justification. The question may lack an answer. Every potential answer may fall victim to a runaway train fallacy, or the answer might be so complex that only few, if any, will understand it. Or whatever answer there is, it may be one involving high-order complexity, as discussed in Experiencing Thinking by O.G. Rose, rendering it impractical, especially over multitudes. If we ask about justification and find there is no answer, we cannot go back, like finally seeing the hidden image of a scrambled pitcher find what the sailor has hidden that the finder cannot unsee once it has been seen. Cursed true. Perhaps we are only justified to believe there is no justification. Should we find out? Wouldn't it be epistemically irresponsible to turn back now? But if we make the choice to move forward, to choose to see what we didn't know we would see, we couldn't turn back, as perhaps it goes with all reading. But even now, you cannot turn back without being epistemically irresponsible, though perhaps still sane. Now, we must move forward to be epistemically responsible, though perhaps insane. In the end, we might conclude there is no objective standard of justification, and because we've read this far, because we cannot unread what we have read, epistemic ethics would compel us to perhaps risk the sense of sanity necessary for any epistemic ethics, would perhaps compel us to perhaps risk the sense of sanity necessary for any epistemic activity to be possible at all. It's like a joke, but not. Yes, I'm intentionally being dramatic here, but what I describe is what it is like to take a pitch and risk, which this paper has speculated epistemic responsibility would often compel us to take. The question of justification is like the question of identity brought up by the ship of thesis thought experiment. If I continue removing parts from a ship, at what point does the ship stop being itself? Conversely, if I started putting pieces together, at what point do the pieces become the ship? Similarly, if parts of me were removed, at what point would I cease to be myself? If the parts of me were separated and began to be assembled, at what point would I begin to be myself? On this line of thought, it should be noted that the question of justification is like a number of serious theological and philosophical questions that we often confront. For example, at what point does a person properly balance practice and philosophy, theology and practice, and so on? At what point should we cease studying justice and begin acting to bring about justice? At what point should we cease trying to understand the world and move to change it? At what point do we cease being responsible for doing something? When we receive 51% of help, or 49%? At what point does a person become moral versus immoral? When 51% of their acts are immoral or 70%? According to what standard? At what point of discussing X have I emphasized it too much in comparison to Y? At what point have I failed to be balanced in my discussion? At what point does X cease to only mean X and rather also means Y? At what point does free speech become hate speech? And so on and so on. Perhaps there is a dialectic here we cannot avoid. Perhaps this question of balance isn't so much for individuals, but for the whole society. Perhaps we should be more concerned about if the society as a whole is balanced versus a given person. We seem capable of everything but balance, especially to others. Do note that even if it could be established that X constitutes justification in one situation, it doesn't follow that X will necessarily constitute justification in a different situation. The problem of justification is part of the question, how do we know something is true? And it should be noted that we must experience truth as something out there, beyond our subjectivity, in order for it to strike us as plausible and hence able to provide us with stability through our daily lives. Truth that isn't out there cannot be a plausibility structure, as Hunter and Peter L. Berger discussed. Yet the justification by which we provide truth a sense of being objective and out there is necessarily based on a subjectivity that is within. Considering this, all truths are always on the verge of failing to provide stability for our daily lives, a notion that will be discussed extensively throughout Belonging Again by O.G. Rose. If there is no objective standard of justification, there is no way to ever escape the possibility of any given plausibility structure failing, meaning we are always susceptible to the existential anxiety that Berger warned is likely to make us rationalize totalitarianism to stabilize, as perhaps some dictators know. The problem of justification is why ideology often proves more powerful than facts. It enables people who want to believe X to find a single piece of evidence for X and believe it without any sense of intellectual dishonesty, as those who want to disbelieve X can disregard it upon finding a single piece of evidence against X. And arguably, there is always at least one piece of evidence for and against any given premise, even when the premise is true. If there is no objective standard of justification, it is likely that this sort of thing is what people will do and continue, contributing to costly tribalism in the midst of pluralism. Considering that we require a hinge for the door of our thoughts to turn, to allude to Wittgenstein, perhaps we are biologically and neurologically wired for accepting or discrediting X as quickly as possible. Perhaps the problem of justification helps us with our biological and neurological needs. Like the problem of justification, there is also a similar problem of credibility. With how many instances of person X telling the truth, am I justified to believe person X is credible? Likewise, with how many mistakes am I justified to believe person Y is not credible? The bar is relative to the person, and thus people who are liberal are likely to have a lower bar for deciding when a conservative pundit has lost credibility, and a lower bar for what a liberal thinker must do to be credible, and vice versa. This can contribute to tribalism and to helping people think they are rational and justified to not take seriously those with whom they disagree. It is perhaps the function of thought to provide us with a sense of certainty and justification in face of the truth that true certainty and justification are impossible. Thought thinks to stabilize in ever instability, a chaos that thought cannot let us catch a glimpse of, lest we never fully or robustly believe in stability again, even if we want to, unless that is we can turn off our brains. Do note that it is perhaps the case that we are toward authoritarianism because we are toward establishing existential stability. The question of justification permeates every sinew of the life of the mind, and yet it is a question I believe we rarely identify and recognize as lurking in the background. It also might be a question that we are unable to answer, threatening to level the whole temple of thought to the ground. If we cannot establish an objective standard of justification to keep the temple up, we still must live like we do. We must live like we have certainty about what we cannot be certain, for without any certainty, we have no standard against which to measure uncertainty. Wittgenstein claimed it belongs to the logic of our scientific investigations that certain things are indeed not doubted. We just can't investigate everything, and for that reason we are forced to rest content with assumption. If I want the door to turn, the hinges must stay put. In other words, if I want to function, even if I can't truly justify what I think, I must act like I can truly justify what I think. And this is exactly what we all do, whether we ultimately must or not, without thinking about it, precisely because perhaps we can't think about it, especially not indeed. If we cannot establish an objective standard of justification, then we can only establish subjective standards, which means there will always be room for debate between people, one who believes four pieces of evidence is justification to believe X, and another who believes five pieces of evidence is justification to believe X, regardless of the severity of the case, the situation X is situated in, and the like. The first person will be justified to believe four pieces is enough, while the second person will be justified to believe one more piece of evidence is needed. The first person will likely think the second is in denial and perhaps an ideologue who doesn't want to believe X, while the second is likely to think the first is too easily persuaded and perhaps even an ideologue who wants to believe X. Both, relative to themselves, will be correct and justified to think this or the other, and problematically, both will have reason to believe the other side cannot be reasoned with, threatening democracy. We have to believe something, axiomatically, in order to have a standard by which to determine what we should believe and what we shouldn't. And yet, if what we believe can only be based on subjective justification, then it would seem we have to believe in something ultimately arbitrary in order to believe in anything at all, such as the belief X is arbitrary. It would seem an ultimately arbitrary belief is needed for us to have a standard against which we could judge arbitrary beliefs from necessary beliefs. One that we will necessarily not truly believe is equally arbitrary with other possible standards, for if we pick X instead of Y, we cannot practically believe X is equal to Y, though we may provide such lip service. Likewise, we cannot truly believe our subjective view is in fact equally subjective. We all necessarily feel our subjectivity is more objective than other subjectivities. Hence, we must all ascribe to an ultimately arbitrary belief that we must practically believe everyone ought to believe as well, though we know to claim otherwise when asked directly. Unless it is we can believe something is true that we know is false. As will be discussed, this poses a major problem for pluralism. The problem of justification is unfortunately abstract and yet practically necessary to solve or to learn to live with. Considering the truism of the rational by O.G. Rose, do note that the question of justification entails the question, at what point are we justified to accept X truth instead of Y truth? And keep in mind that it is relative to what we believe is true that we determine what we believe is rational. If I think it's going to rain today, it is rational to bring an umbrella. If it doesn't rain, I still acted rationally. Being true determines the towardness of being rational. Considering this, if I accept X truth, I transform what constitutes being rational to myself, which is especially dramatic if previously I accepted Y as my truth and define rationality relative to why. Hence, the question of justification is the question of at what point am I justified to accept a truth that will change my entire structure of rationality? And keep in mind that if I change from Y to X, how can I do so without potentially invalidating the entire rationality which perhaps helped me decide I should accept X instead of Y? Why am I justified to perhaps engage in this contradiction and even hypocrisy? Point two. To be epistemically responsible is to not believe something until we are justified to believe it. Hence, if there is no objective standard of justification, there is no objective standard against which to define epistemic responsibility according to the right method, evidence, logic, and so on, as has already been discussed. Do note that if we cannot determine when a person is justified to believe X, then we cannot determine when it is epistemically responsible for a given person to believe X except by the subjective and relative measures and standards. If this is the case, justification is not only helpless to stop tribalism and pluralistic collapse in our age of pluralism, but it is also the case that justification will precisely make the problem worse. Seeing as there will be no way to stop people from ascribing to their own personal standards of justification against which they define themselves as epistemically responsible and others as epistemically irresponsible. This will lead people to becoming increasingly tribal and intellectually self-segregated, all while thinking of themselves as intellectually honest and open to a convincing argument. Is justification an ought? If we ask at what point is X justified, are we asking at what point ought X be believed? Likewise, if we ask at what point are we justified and epistemically responsible to leap from X to Y, are we asking at what point ought we leap from X to Y? It would seem so. If X is justified, it would seem we ought to believe, trust in, assume, and or live according to X. Furthermore, if X is justified, it would seem we ought to feel compelled to believe X. The point at which a conservative is justified to become a liberal would seem to be the point at which a conservative ought to become a liberal. For if a conservative is justified to become a liberal, it would suggest there is reason to be liberal over being conservative. If I am only justified to say liberalism is equally as justified as conservatism, then I'm not really justified to change from conservatism to liberalism. If I do change, it would be a neutral choice, but also really, but not really a justified choice. I would be justified to be a liberal, but not so much to leap into liberalism. If anything, it seems I would be more justified to stay a conservative, seeing as it has worked for me up to that point, and seeing as I don't yet know if liberalism will be as practically justified as conservatism. I would need more evidence on the side of liberalism to justify making the leap, despite the practical evidence. A justification implies an ought. After all, justification orients epistemic responsibility, and what is ethics if not an ought? Hence, if there is no objective standard for justification, there is no way to establish an objective ought. It is not possible to establish that everyone ought to believe X. If there are only subjective standards of justification, then there are only subjective oughts in regard to what people should believe, and if that is the case, there is no way for me to make it epistemically responsible for you to believe X, as there is no way for you to make it epistemically responsible for me to believe Y. Likewise, there is no way for the state, church, community, so forth, to make it epistemically responsible for the people to believe X. And if that is impossible, it would seem incredibly difficult for a government to keep a civilization stable for long. If there are only or predominantly subjective standards of justification, then what people believe is what people will never ought not to believe. And in this way, the map is indestructible. But the standard can always be shifted before it obligates us to disbelieve, discredits what we think, or likewise, what people believe is what people cannot be necessarily compelled to disbelieve. This doesn't mean people can't change their minds or choose to submit themselves to a given standard of justification, but it does mean that no one must do so. And that it's unlikely a given person who is emotionally invested will. If we believe that X justifies believing Y, we must think everyone should be compelled by X to believe Y. That because X is true, people ought to believe Y, and we're even prone to go so far as to think it's self-evident, only to the degree it is unobvious to us as to the degree we think it to be unobvious to others. If people don't believe X and Y are true, our very belief in Y through X would justify us to think others, to think of those others as failing to be rational, intellectually honest, and epistemically responsible. The act of believing in Y is an act which is inescapably frames others. To believe is to color. Belief always portrays. If we believe X is justified at point Z, we will necessarily believe that everyone should believe X at Z, unless that is we believe that what justifies X to us shouldn't be what justifies X to everyone. If we believe the pro-life position is proven with 5 strong arguments, we will necessarily believe that the pro-life position should be proven to everyone who here sees those 5 arguments, unless that is we believe what convinces us shouldn't convince everyone else, which would be for us to believe something that is nonsensical and that which only a minority is likely to accept, if anyone. If we believe that 5 pieces of evidence justifies belief in X case to us, but 7 pieces of evidence justifies belief in X case to others, we believe that who a person is changes the logicalness or truthfulness of a given justification or case. This is a kind of ad hominem fallacy, and such illogic is likely to eventually become apparent to us. Sure, people are convinced that different amounts of evidence, but acknowledging this is different from believing people should be convinced by different amounts of evidence. To be intellectually coherent, we must believe that if we are convinced by Z to believe X, everyone ought to be convinced by Z to believe X, for otherwise we wouldn't think Z was convincing. But paradoxically, if standards of justification are ultimately subjective, then what we must believe that everyone should think is that which is ultimately arbitrary. We must necessarily think that what is arbitrary isn't arbitrary. We must think everyone ought to believe X because we believe X, as others must think them everyone ought to believe Y because they believe Y. The nature of thought itself forces us into this problem, this paradox. If we believe X is justified by Z, we must project over everyone that we encounter that relative to them too, X is justified by Z. Since when we experience Z, we experience it as justification for X, we must think that everyone who experiences Y also experiences it as justification for X. Hence, if people experience Z and don't believe in X, we must think they are being intellectually dishonest, ideological, biased, so forth. If people experience Z and aren't compelled by it to believe X, we must think they are being epistemically irresponsible. And the nature of reality is such that we cannot not have standards of justification like Z. The nature of reality is such that we cannot not eventually be in a situation where if we are being logical according to the standard of justification we quote-unquote arbitrarily accept, we must think of others as epistemically irresponsible, who relative to them are being epistemically responsible, and we, the epistemically irresponsible ones. The nature of reality itself primes us not only for misunderstanding, but for misunderstanding that we can't even experience as misunderstanding. To elaborate, if we encounter someone who does agree with our standard of justification of Z for X, then we will likely believe that the person is intellectually honest and epistemically responsible when this may not be the case. Or perhaps is only the case for this instant. It doesn't follow that a person who is epistemically responsible in one instance is always such. Like the nature of thought described in the Phenomenology of True Ignorance by O.G. Rose, it would seem the nature of justification primes us for confirmation bias, including the confirmation bias that we don't fall victim to confirmation bias. To allude to compelling by O.G. Rose, at what point ought people be compelled to believe X instead of Y? Do note that to change a standard of justification is to change at what point people ought to be compelled to believe a given premise. If there are only subjective standards of justification, there will be no way to establish objectivity that X is that which everyone ought to be compelled to believe, and or X is compelling, and consequently everyone will necessarily believe that their truth and its corresponding standard of justification ought to be the truth and standard of justification for all people. People who fail to agree are those who necessarily, according to everyone's standards of justification, fails to be reasonable and intellectually honest and the like. It might ultimately be the case that because of varying standards of justification, we cannot ultimately compel anyone to believe anything, especially if they are creative and smart enough to endlessly rearrange the variables of their ideology, especially if the map is indestructible per se. If this is so, then at the end of the day, it is ultimately going to be action and or the will to act that will change the world versus argument. In a world with subjective standards of justification, action is more likely to compel, justify, and change than argument, though it is not the case that those changed by action will be those who accept or understand the changes, raising the possibility of social unrest. This hints at the possibility that violence, war, revolution, protesting, and the like are necessary and unavoidable for Y to come to be accepted over X, regardless if Y is better than X, though if Y is accepted over X, it will necessarily seem as if Y is better, given that Y doesn't give rise to obvious bloodshed, mass poverty, bigotry, and so forth. This being the case, there is also more incentive to act than to think, though it is still the case that thoughtless action is more likely to cause error than is thoughtful action. The case that thoughtless action will cause more error, though it doesn't follow that thoughtful action is necessarily good or without error. If action is what is more likely to compel than argument, then it is probable that the ideology which is most likely to stimulate action is the ideology most likely to compel and flip civilization in its favor. As discussed in the heart-mind dialectic and the phenomenology of views, this is likely the ideology which emotion favors, for the majority is more likely to act for emotional reasons than intellectual reasons, which isn't always a bad thing, perhaps precisely because the standards of intellectual justification shift. Unfortunately, if this is always the case, the likelihood that the shooting begins and pluralism collapse into social unrest is great, to allude to the work of James Hunter, as will be discussed in Belonging Again. To elaborate, this all points to the brilliance of Martin Luther King's nonviolent resistance, which caused existential reflection in white supremacists, often causing the supremacists to change themselves. MLK's efforts didn't force people to change, but forced people to see themselves in a way that horrified them and that made them run from themselves. By resisting nonviolently, the resistor lets the actions and will of the aggressor run uninterrupted, which robbed the aggressor of the ease of rationalizing and avoiding existential reflection. By physically resisting, a person allows the aggressor to rationalize his actions. He can say, I was defending myself, or I was doing my job, etc. By not resisting, no such rationalization can occur, or at least not easily. This makes existential reflection all the more difficult to avoid, along with the realization of one's own monstrosity, immorality, and cruelty. This doesn't mean there is never a place for direct resistance, but it does mean that if we want to change hearts and minds, we must resist in a manner that makes it difficult for hearts and minds to avoid seeing themselves. This is explored and expanded on in the paper Equality and Its Immoral Limits. For further elaboration, if it is the case that no one must ever shift from X to Y, then it is likely that those who do shift do so for emotional versus intellectual reasons, thanks to action. And if it is the case, and if this is the case, art is more likely to change what people believe than is philosophy. Furthermore, empathetic genius is more likely to change people than is intellectual brilliance. Lastly, it should be noted that it is unlikely that we will be able to keep history from repeating itself, seeing as we don't learn from history how the people of history felt. We only learn from history the facts of history, if even those. Those who in the past made a grave mistake often, if not always, found themselves in an ideology that contributed to that mistake. And if the map is indestructible, it was emotions that were needed to help people escape that ideology. Those feelings mustn't have come about. And if we learn from history how people felt, this versus thought, we might prove ourselves equipped to stop ourselves from repeating the mistakes of history. If minorities were mistreated in the past because, for whatever reason, it became epistemically responsible to mistreat minorities or to do nothing as others mistreated them, failing to understand the conflict of mind, it is likely we will fail to stop this from happening again. It is very possible that is epistemic responsibility, which continues to make history repeat, and since we don't learn to feel from history, we don't learn to break the cycle. It seems it would be unnatural for us to be intellectually and emotionally equipped to avoid repeating history. To elaborate more, what constitutes our standard of justification is a standard which we must necessarily think everyone who is epistemically responsible should ascribe to. Otherwise, we are guilty of a kind of existentially unnerving ad hominem fallacy. It's hard to say. Our standard tends to be self-evident to us. If we believe case X thanks to five pieces of evidence, it tends to be self-evident to us that these five pieces of evidence should convince anyone of case X, and hence we innocently think that it is also self-evident to everyone else. Otherwise, they must be unintelligent, epistemically irresponsible, or ideological. This costly tribe-creating phenomenon is what could be called the self-deception of the self-evident, and it is similar to how when we speak, what we are trying to say tends to strike us as obvious, how when we write, what we mean is crystal clear, and so it is hard for us to truly understand why others don't understand us. Since our words seemingly wear their meanings to us, it is easy to forget that to others our words appear bare. Steven Pinker refers to this phenomenon as the curse of knowledge in his brilliant The Sense of Style, and I think his curse of knowledge applies well to the problem of justification. To elaborate more, whatever truth we believe ought to be the truth is likely to be in line with whatever ideology into which we were born, seeing as we can shift standards of justification and hence avoid ever feeling compelled to change our ideology and hurt our family, our tribe, for example, and so forth, and for example. And seeing as our first ideology is the hens, thanks to which the door of our worldview functions, to allude to Wittgenstein, to change that is to risk breaking. Also, the ideology of a given person will necessarily feel like he or she ought to keep ascribing to it, and so it is likely that people trying to be intellectually honest will conclude that they ought to keep believing their first ideology. Birth rate seems likely to be the best indication of the future mindset of the globe, considering all this. What ought we do if someone calls us and tells us a bomb is about to go off, to allude to the earlier example? Ought we to gather more evidence, or would the severity of the claim and the limitness of time make it that we ought to take it seriously? What we ought to do isn't clear. By the way, a dictator who wanted to control a country would be demonically wise to put his or her citizenry, people, in this kind of situation as often as possible. Also, Hume's it-is-ought problem could be relevant here. Perhaps as we cannot leap from X is X to X ought to be X, so perhaps we cannot move from I believe X to I am justified to believe X. Solutions to Hume's guillotine could help with the problem of justification. And if we are justified to take a pitch and risk, is it the case that we ought to take it? If so, it would seem epistemic responsibility could be a curse, and yet also what makes possible rational civilization. Perhaps it is because epistemic responsibility compels the taking of pitch and risks that so many geniuses go mad. Hard to say. Point three. It was established earlier that total certainty is impossible, only practical certainty that is practically indefinable from total certainty. Hence, what is being searched for in this section isn't Platonic total justification, but the possibility of a standard of practical justification for a fitting situation. Do note that there can be a different standard per situation, assuming there be one for any situation. To offer some positive news, I do believe there is at least one standard of justification that can be used in certain, if not many, situations, and in regard to certain, if not many, kinds of truth. This is the standard of falsification in liberal science discussed by Jonathan Rout, C.S. Pierce, Karl Popper. Falsification, in my opinion, is the crown jewel of epistemology. For it, we owe these great minds much. Falsification is so useful and wonderful that I personally am tempted to become a falsification monotheorist, a temptation perhaps many scientists have given into, understandably. But I'm afraid I cannot be justified to make the claim that all truths are falsifiable. As we discussed earlier, it is not so, but how much easier would the life of the mind be if it was? We wouldn't have to think about religion like Christianity, theories like intersectionality, or difficult works of art like Ulysses by Joyce. And how much more likely would it be that pluralism didn't self-destruct if falsification could be a legitimate monotheory, a truth that perhaps the New Age atheists understand all too well. If someone called me and told me that a bomb was about to go off, I probably couldn't falsify it until the bomb went off. If a man who lied often told me something, by the time I finished falsifying the last two claims, there would already be another claim I needed to falsify. If a reporter came out claiming the president was being blackmailed by Russia to start a war in 2 days, even if I could falsify it, I wouldn't have the time. If a young Mother Teresa claimed God told her to serve in Calcutta, I couldn't falsify her claim and arguably shouldn't, and so on and so on. Indeed, falsification could be used to determine if Hemingway was right about the CIA spying on him, but it couldn't while Hemingway was still alive. Unfortunately, falsification is often practically useless, even though it is a legitimate standard of justification and perhaps the only legitimate one. Falsification is often useless in real time. It is much better suited for the laboratory, and the laboratory is like a tomb that on the third day we try to push open, but the stone proves too heavy. Falsification is a tool we can use to help us be epistemically responsible and so justified to believe X, but it only applies to truths that can be falsified, and it is often practically useless in real time. Still, it's better than nothing, and falsification does help us manage our perhaps likely true knowledge over and or against perhaps true beliefs, even though we are still left with the problem of figuring out how to manage our perhaps true beliefs. To elaborate, in many ways, the problem of justification is identical with the problem of verification. The question of at what point are we justified to believe X is like the question, at what point have we verified X? It is not surprising, then, that Popper's response to Hume, who most famously noted the problem of induction and verification, would also be a proper response to the problem of justification. Falsification makes possible the establishment of some universal oughts on grounds of practical certainty, contributing to the possibility of pluralistic unity. But to elaborate, but does falsification actually help with the problem of justification? For at what point has X avoided falsification long enough for us to be justified to believe X? How could I be justified to claim at point Y versus at point Z? What is the number of tests that X must pass before it is epistemically responsible to believe X? Wouldn't 3 tests be better than 2? Isn't it more justified to believe a theory that avoids falsification 3 times versus a theory that only avoids it twice? It would seem that falsification works by first deciding if X could be falsified. Then, once it has passed at least one serious attempt to falsify it, there is reason to believe X is true. X has earned it. Before the experiment, our relation to X should be one of neither belief nor disbelief. We should withhold our judgment until after the experiment. Then, once X has passed the test, we have reason to believe X is true. And here, and hence, to make X is true, our new default. The more times we try to falsify X and X passes those attempts, the more justified we are to believe X. For X to pass a single test of falsification is for a person to be justified to believe X is true, but at this point, the person is only weakly justified. To increase the robustness of the justification, the person should have other people try to falsify X, to be sure that subjectivity isn't playing a role, and seeing as the person is justified to ask others to attempt, considering he or she has reason to believe X is true thanks to previous and personal falsification attempts. The more people who attempt to falsify X, the more X continues to be true, the more justified people are to believe X is true. The more times X avoids falsification, the more people are strongly justified to believe in X. At what point are we justified to stop attempting to falsify X and just assume X is true forever forth? More evidence is better, obviously, but if we cannot establish the standard by which we are justified to say that is enough, we'll find ourselves forever having to retest premises, such as we need air to survive, gravity exists, and so on, and epistemically responsible for doing so. Unfortunately, theoretically, it doesn't seem to me that falsification can avoid a runaway train fallacy. If we establish that it is better for X to be falsified 6 times versus 5 by different people, it follows that we should falsify X 10 times versus 6, 20 versus 15, and so on. Fortunately, practically speaking, I do think there is hope, based on perhaps Hume's natural belief, as discussed in Deconstructing Common Life, which will come later. Falsification is a unique epistemological tool in that the method makes possible a practical certainty that is practically indefinable from total certainty about X. If X stands after 100 attempts to falsify by 100 different people, though it would be better for X to stand up to testing a billion times more, at this point we have reason to be practically certain about X. To live like X is true, especially since the attempts were done by diverse people. If one day, as we are living, something occurs that gives us reason to believe X is false, then yes, we should retest X. But after 100 or so tests, there's no specific number. We are justified to begin living as if X is true, to adopt the premise into our default more for engaging with life, default mode. No, we can never be fully justified to say X is true, thanks to falsification. Popper considering Hume acknowledged such, but we can be justified to live as if X is true, and that is practically good enough. Having earned practical certainty that is practically indefinable from total certainty about X, we have reason to make X one of the premises that functions as a hinge upon which the door of our thinking swings, to allude to Wittgenstein again. If something occurs that gives us reason to believe X should no longer be such a hinge, then we should retest X, but thanks to falsification, it is possible to establish a practical certainty about X that justifies us living as if X is true. In so much as we don't live in a way that closes off X from the possibility of falsification. We must always keep that possibility open and keep in mind, as Wittgenstein said, that we must have some assumption that we are forced to rest content with. Falsification makes the achievement of a practical justification that is practically indefinable from objective justification, which puts us in a much better situation with what we can falsify than with what we cannot, hence making it tempting in our pluralistic age to only consider premises that can be falsified as possibly true. In many respects, it would seem epistemically responsible to be so conclusive, exclusive, but seeing as epistemic responsibility is relative to method and the kind of truth that the epistemic responsibility is toward, this is not the case. But do not be quick to fault those who think it. It is. Pluralism would seem to have a better chance of holding together if all truths were falsifiable. Falsification can provide us with practical certainty that justifies living as if certain premises are true. But is the kind of practical justification possible with what cannot be falsified? It does not seem so. Point four. If there are no objective standards of justification for what cannot be falsified, then there is no way to make it epistemically responsible for someone to believe something that the person doesn't already believe. This doesn't mean that people can't change their minds, but it does mean that people don't have to change their minds. This is especially unlikely if the argumentation isn't accompanied by action, or there is action that undermines the argumentation. For example, Christians don't act like Christians. Realizing this could incentivize people to be sure their intellectualism is accompanied by action, but at the same time, it could be used to rationalize actors not taking seriously the life of the mind. To realize action convinces us more than argument could be used to justify not only abstaining from participating in democracy, but to also justify overriding it with action. If there are no objective standards of justification for the unfalsifiable, there are no objective standards by which we can establish by which it can be established that one ought to be convinced and or compelled. Consequently, no one ever ought to change their minds in regard to what cannot be falsified. At the same time, without such objective standards, we cannot establish that we ought to have certainty about X and not Y, nor that we ought to use X instead of Y as one of the hinges upon which the door of our thinking should swing, to allude to Wittgenstein. We require a certainty that we cannot establish we ought to have in order to have a standard against which even to measure uncertainty, to even say we are in fact uncertain, and to even establish what ought to be believed or disbelieved. What makes possible escape from intellectual nihilism is that which we cannot intellectualize. In regard to what can be falsified, we can achieve practical certainty and practical justification, and hence it is possible to be practically epistemically responsible, at least to some degree. But again, what are we to do in regard to unfalsifiable truths? Moving forward, this paper will assume there are no objective standards of justification that can be established beyond falsification. And unfortunately, it is not the case that we can establish that everything that is true is falsifiable. Accepting this Kafkaesque reality, we must now turn to the question of what we are to do about the problem of pluralism, a dilemma that the gravity the works of O.G. Rose never seems able to escape. If there is a greater thinker out there who can establish objective standards and or methods of justification, we as a civilization should be forever grateful to that individual. Hopefully, even that thinker, even if that thinker arises, the closing sections of this paper, which will be greatly indebted to the works of James Davison Hunter, will still prove useful. This has been The Conflict of Mind by O.G. Rose, part 3. Thank you for your time. For more by O.G. Rose, please visit ogrose.com. YouTube, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, follow, shares, all are greatly appreciated. And thank you for your time.